Hello, good morning everybody. Buenos días a todos. Bon dia a tothom. We'll begin this conference and I begin this opening words by giving the floor and handing over to our Vice Rector for Research at the UPF, a la Universitat Pompeu Fabra, Enric Valldubí.
Okay, welcome. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Barcelona, Universitat Pompeu Fabra, and this Poblenou campus devoted to communication, language, and information and communications technologies. I'm here. It's a pleasure to be able to welcome you here today on behalf of Rector Jaume Casals, who's committed elsewhere. Out of town, so I'm here in his stead. And I don't know, I basically, my job here is to wish you a very fruitful, enjoyable conference, the second International Conference on Academic Communication Journals. As Vice Director of Research, I'm aware of the relevance and the essential character of dissemination. I mean, research is at the core of our raison d'etre as academics, but you know, if research doesn't get disseminated, if it doesn't reach out, if it doesn't get to not only to the wider academic community, but to society in general, there's basically no point to it. You know, we need you, we need everybody. Researchers need communication professionals, journals are also essential to our trade. As researchers. I finished my PhD in 1990, so you know, it's a long time ago. I'm a linguist. Basically, there were five journals you know, I had to read when I was doing my dissertation research. Things have changed a lot, not only in quantity, but also in terms of resources, the means, how things are done. I think this campus is interesting in mixing, you know, communication and technologies, because this is the way things are working today in all respects, but essentially also in terms of publishing. And as part of my job today, I mean, I'm Vice Rector, I've been Vice Rector for a few weeks now only, but one of the first things that I was actually pointed to is at, you know, the relevance of this issue and how our publications get spread out to the community. And that's definitely an area in which a lot needs to be done and in which cooperation, mutual knowledge is essential. So I hope this this conference is fruitful in that respect, and that you know, that leads to good, deep collaboration between the academic community and the publishing community. So having said that, welcome again and have a great day. Or couple of days?
Only one day.
Day. If you stay in Barcelona for the weekend, enjoy that too, okay? So thank you very much for being here and have a great time.
Thank you very much. As most of you already know, UPF is a public urban university as well as a young one. We have only 26 years. We are only 26 years old. However, it has achieved quite a reputation among academics due to the quality of our teaching and also the quality of an impact of our scientific productivity. Besides that, at the UPF, communication studies play an important role, as we are one of only we are only 8 departments in this university, and the communication department is one of them. And also, our teaching and research has been positively assessed by the academic authorities in Catalonia. Today, we are hosting this conference on academic communication journals. It's its second edition. The first one took place 2 years ago. And I hope you're going to find it useful and full of insights for your future work, and which I believe will be a great opportunity to learn, to debate, and to share about the pitfalls, the challenges, and opportunities that communication journals have to face in the future. Thanks to the Vice Rector for his opening words. Thanks to the organizing committee for their brilliant and hard work, and thank you all for being here. I wish you all a useful and pleasant conference, and for those of you coming from abroad, a wonderful stay in our university and our city. Thank you very much. And now it's time to begin our opening lectures, so I'll hand over to Professor Rafael Pedraza, who will introduce the first speakers, our opening lectures.
Okay, so good morning, everybody. It is nice to see you all here. Thank you very much for coming, and welcome to the second International Conference on Academic Communication Journals. My name is Rafael Pedraza. I'm associate tenure-track associate professor at Pompeu Fabra University, and I will be with you as chairman of this first session in the conference. Well, before we start with the opening lectures, I would like to explain some aspects of the conference program. Today, we have, as you can see in your programs, today we have three sessions, a morning session, this one, and two simultaneous afternoon sessions. We will make the time for lunch at 1 p.m. and we will back and restart the afternoon session at 3 o'clock. During the morning session, we will have four presentations, scheduled as two opening lectures and two keynotes. At the end of the session, we have a round table. Approximately at 11:30, between the opening lectures and keynotes, we will have the coffee break. The opening lectures will be carried out by Dr. Emilio Delgado López Cózar, next to me, in my immediate right, from the University of Granada, and Dr. Ismael Raffles, on my left, from the Polytechnic University of Valencia, and also from the University of Sussex. And the keynotes after the coffee break will be carried out by Mr. Steve Smith from Kudos. Thank you very much for coming. And Dr. Karen Boyle from the University of Stirling, that I can't see here, but she's here. Each presentation will last approximately 20 minutes. After the opening lectures, if we are on time, all of you, the attendees, can ask both speakers a question related to their presentation. But if we are not on time, I would be very grateful if you can ask at the end of the session in the round table, okay? Well, we will follow a similar structure in the keynotes. In this case, you can ask the keynote speakers directly as at the roundtable. Okay. Well, the roundtable is programmed approximately at 12 p.m. In relation to the roundtable, one of the main objectives of this conference is to meet together and to intercommunicate. So please, you are invited to ask, to speak, and to participate in the roundtable, okay? Now, another question. In relation to the language used by the speakers, in this conference, this is an international multilingual conference, so the speakers will use Catalan, Spanish, or English, whichever they prefer, okay? On the other hand, in relation to the afternoon sessions, they are focused on communication journals. One is devoted to international journals and the other to national journals, but from the point of view of the nationality of the journal, not by its scope. I mean, all journals with present in both session in the afternoon and represented by the editors have international reach. Okay. The International Communication Journal session will take place in room 55309 in other building. Okay. You can find it in your program. And the National Communication Journal sessions will take place in room 55410. The volunteers at the door of this auditorium will help you to find this room later, okay? Well, now I think it's time to start the opening lectures. A nuestro primer conferenciante lo voy a presentar en castellano. Él es el doctor Emilio Delgado López Cózar. Emilio es catedrático de metodología de la investigación en la Facultad de Comunicación y Documentación de la Universidad de Granada. Es creador de una gran cantidad, yo diría que una ingente cantidad, de sistemas y herramientas para la evaluación científica, como el H-Index Scholar, INREX, INREC, el Journal Scholar Metrics, el índice H de las revistas españolas según Google Scholar Metrics, Scholar Mirrors, Co-Author Index, Publisher Scholar Metrics, RES, Revistas Españolas de Ciencias Sociales y Humanas, CIRC, Clasificación Integrada de Revistas Científicas, el Ranking IUGR de Universidades Españolas o el DNA, el Directorio Nacional de Autores, entre otras muchas. La producción es increíble. Cuenta con más de 200 publicaciones y es el fundador del Grupo de Investigación Evaluación de la Ciencia y de la Comunicación Científica. Sus líneas de investigación se centran en el estudio de Google Scholar, de hecho hoy nos va a hablar, va a estar centrado en Google Scholar, como fuente de información y evaluación científica, también en la evaluación del rendimiento científico de instituciones e investigadores, en la evaluación de revistas científicas, en el análisis de sistemas de evaluación de la ciencia española y en el estudio de la situación de la investigación española en documentación. Hoy tenemos la enorme suerte de contar con él para nuestras conferencias de apertura. Su conferencia se titula Revolución de Google Scholar, descubriendo la caja de Pandora académica. Y Emilio, cuando quieras. Tenéis que apuntar. Sí. No sé si está. No está bien.
Creo que, aunque vengo invitado para hablar fundamentalmente de Google Scholar, tengo que decirles que hablaré de eso, pero también hablaré del contexto en el que Google Scholar creo que está actuando. Creo que hay una transformación revolucionaria en el campo de la comunicación científica, puesto que estamos en un congreso de comunicación, de revistas de comunicación, por tanto, comunicación sobre la comunicación. Creo que debo de hablar de cuáles son las transformaciones que se están produciendo y enmarcar la aparición de Google Scholar dentro de esas transformaciones. Pero advierto que para hablar de comunicación hay que hablar de evaluación. porque digo la evaluación de los científicos, porque la evaluación está condicionando radicalmente la forma en que nos estamos comunicando. Por tanto, hablaré de tres cosas: de la transformación de la comunicación, de Google Scholar en ese contexto, qué papel juega, y por último, si llego, porque no sé si seré capaz de transmitir tantas transparencias en tan poco tiempo, pues bueno, si voy un poco rápido y alocado, es el intento de mandar mensajes, en algunos casos provocadores, para que generemos reflexión, ¿no? Bien, yo hace años, en el año 1991, escribía un artículo donde yo, sin saberlo, tengo que decir, entreveía que había un cambio en los procesos de comunicación provocado fundamentalmente por las tecnologías de información. Realmente los cambios en la comunicación siempre se han producido porque ha habido cambios en las tecnologías. La imprenta generó una revolución en el siglo XV y en los 90 aparecía un cambio generado por las nuevas tecnologías que yo creo que ha cambiado radicalmente y cambiará todavía más en el futuro la forma en que nos comunicamos los científicos. La botella camina. Bien, si tuviera que sintetizar cuáles son los cambios, yo diría que en el antiguo modelo, en la galaxia Gutenberg científica, me refiero, el elemento distintivo es que el poder para transmitir la información estaba controlado por los editores, bien de publicaciones de editoriales, bien de revistas. Ellos decidían lo que se publicaba y el autor no podía hacer nada. Evidentemente, además, en el ámbito científico existían dos filtros. El primer filtro, ahora estoy hablando de las revistas, fundamentalmente las revistas son en casi todos los campos el principal medio de comunicación de resultados de investigación. Existían dos filtros. El primer filtro, el del editor con sus revisores para decidir qué es lo que se publica o no se publica, de acuerdo con las convenciones del método científico. Y esas revistas después tenían que sufrir otro filtro, que es el que establecía las bases de datos, entre ellas y especialmente la Web of Science, ese club selecto donde todo el mundo quiere estar y donde no todo el mundo podía estar, ¿vale? Bien, por tanto, hay un doble filtro, un doble control sobre lo que se produce. ¿Cuál es el cambio que genera la galaxia web? Pues fundamentalmente yo creo que la galaxia web lo que hace es que da la voz a los que no la tenían. Y digo también y añado altavoz a los que ya la tenían. Esto es un cambio absolutamente revolucionario. Cualquiera puede contar sus descubrimientos sin ningún control. Además, permitió hacer lo que McLuhan hablaba de aquella aldea global. Qué metáfora tan bonita, aldea y global. Interconectó a los científicos. Yo, porque tengo canas, vengo del homo tipográficos, del, suelo decir, de la, yo soy de la generación 0.1, de la digital de dedo, ¿vale? Y, oye, no podíamos conectar de manera fácil con los científicos de cualquier parte del mundo. Hoy estamos interconectados. Esto es también absolutamente revolucionario en la ciencia. Pero no solo eso, el autor es capaz de apropiarse de todo el sistema de comunicación científica. Es decir, el autor puede editar, puede publicar y diseminar él mismo con herramientas que están al alcance de todo. Eso me parece también que es revolucionario. Y todavía más revolucionario es lo que viene ahora. El autor conecta con el lector. He puesto allí en la esquina superior lo que pasaba antiguamente. El autor clamando en el desierto. ¿Escribía para quién? ¿Quién eran sus lectores? Evidentemente existían lectores, pero no eran conocidos. Hoy, el autor sabe en tiempo real, y esto es revolucionario y no sé qué consecuencias de carácter sociológico tendrán, creo que muy interesante en el futuro, sabe en tiempo real quién le está leyendo, quién le está siguiendo, quién le está retuiteando. Todo. No sé qué consecuencias tendrá esto. En principio siempre, todos los cambios tecnológicos, como cualquier tecnología, tienen una parte, una cara amable y una cara negra, ¿no? El lado negro de la fuerza o el lado agradable de la fuerza. Desde el punto de vista de la comunicación, la galaxia web lo que hizo es que multiplicó los canales de comunicación científica. Empezamos por la primera generación, que son las páginas web, seguimos después, no están en el mismo orden en que surgieron, ¿no? Los repositorios, auténticos almacenes de información científica, que pueden ser alternativos a los medios tradicionales de comunicación, los blogs, los vídeos, YouTube, está transformando la manera de comunicar y de enseñar. Aviso a navegantes a los que nos dedicamos a enseñar. Muchos estudiantes aprenden hoy en YouTube y no en nuestras aulas. Y esto se reforzará. Y lo hace cualquier persona que tenga conocimiento y capacidades para comunicar algo. Las redes sociales, que voy a decir de ellas, y las redes sociales académicas y científicas, que están arrasando. Esta capacidad, por tanto, de nuevos canales de comunicación hace que aumente la cantidad de documentos, la masa de información circulante en el mundo. Y permita, por tanto, también por primera vez, que tengamos acceso abierto al conocimiento. Y esto es también revolucionario y con unos efectos magníficos, se supone, para la generación de nuevo conocimiento. Más conocimiento debe provocar más conocimiento y este más así. Estaríamos en lo que llamaríamos el círculo virtuoso de la comunicación. ¿Vale? Bueno, con esta masa de comunicación científica circulando por todos los mares del conocimiento, con 100.000 puertos donde atracar, necesitábamos un barco, alguien que transportara la información, que pusiera en comunicación esos puertos. Pues bien, ahí aparecen los buscadores, a mi entender, y en concreto Google Scholar. Es ese barco que nos permite aprovisionarnos de información. Y he puesto este. Yo sé que hay muchos más. Joyce Codina de vez en cuando nos lo recuerda. No solo está Google y Google Scholar, pero la gente se obceca en usarlo. ¿Qué le vamos a hacer? De todas maneras, recordad siempre que los imperios no duran siempre. No sé si estará por aquí Rodríguez Gairín. No lo sé, bueno. ¿Quién se acuerda de Alta Vista? Él, desde luego, se acuerda, porque hizo un trabajo seminal y precursor de muchos trabajos que han venido después para medir la evaluación. ¿Quién se acuerda de Alta Vista? ¿Quién se acuerda de WordPerfect? ¿Quién se acuerda de Netscape? Nos acordamos los que tenemos cana. Pero han desaparecido literalmente. ¿Quién se acuerda de Explorer? Bueno, todavía nos acordamos de Explorer porque Microsoft está detrás, pero bueno, no sé si esto pasará con Google, Google Scholar. Puede pasar, puede pasar. Los imperios caen. Mirad en perspectiva lo que es la historia. Pero bueno, de momento Google Scholar se ha convertido, desde luego, en el principal buscador académico. ¿Y por qué ha sido? Pues simplemente por eso, porque es simple, porque es sencillo, porque es rápido, rápido. Mirad, siempre la obsesión es responder a las búsquedas de manera muy rápida, milisegundos. Es fácil de entender, es fácil de usar, es universal, realmente universal. Ese barco llega a todos los puertos del mundo. Los anteriores barcos del mundo de la comunicación científica solo atracaban en Londres, en Boston, en Berkeley y en más sitios. La periferia no existía. Para este buscador, todos los puertos, en todos los puertos conviene atracar. Evidentemente, a uno le gusta aprovisionarse más de unos que de otros. Es multilingüe. Y digo multilingüe, están todas las lenguas. Todas las lenguas. Todas. All. Y además, y este yo creo que es también una clave de su éxito, es gratuito. No nos cuesta. Claro, eso ayuda mucho, la verdad. No lo digo yo. A nosotros nos gustan las evidencias empíricas. Y hemos montado un blog, un newsletter y una cuenta de Twitter donde nosotros vamos transmitiendo todos los trabajos científicos que se refieren a Google Scholar. Y las evidencias son aplastantes. Google Scholar es hoy día en casi todos los campos de conocimiento. Hay siempre diferencias entre disciplinas. Estoy haciendo una generalización, pero a pesar de las pequeñas diferencias entre disciplinas, es el principal buscador científico del mundo, el más usado. Nos dio por averiguar el tamaño, porque el tamaño importa. En otros temas, bastante. Y hace 2 años averiguamos que Google Scholar pues tenía 170 millones de documentos. Miren la diferencia respecto al resto de bases de carácter científico. Y da igual, hemos hecho muchos estudios y muchos estudios con distintas fuentes generadas de Google Scholar. La primera, en la parte superior izquierda, un estudio sobre biblioteconomía y documentación de revistas, ahora ya estamos hablando de revistas, y utilizando Google Scholar. Ya ves las diferencias con las bases de datos que se han utilizado tradicionalmente para buscar información científica. Si vamos a Google Scholar Metrics, a la derecha, y vemos el caso de España, ya veis la diferencia entre el número de revistas indizadas en Google Scholar Metrics, que es restrictivo, recuerden, 100 artículos en 5 años y al menos una cita. Por tanto, no están todas las que sí están en Google Scholar, están todas. Si miramos comunicación, y esto es interesante para lo que estamos viviendo aquí, pues las diferencias también son importantes. No sigo porque no me va a dar tiempo. Da igual que miremos revistas, si miramos autores, miren mi caso, pues pueden ver la diferencia en el número de documentos y de citas que son capaces de captar Google Scholar. El tamaño importa porque quiere decir que es capaz de captar toda la variedad del impacto científico y no científico, como diré a continuación. Y fíjense ahí ResearchGate, como ya se ha colado respecto al resto de la base de datos. Pongo aparte a Web of Science, ese club selecto anhelado por todas las revistas, porque ahí hay una parte oculta. Ven que hay como un velo. El velo tiene que ver a las citas que aparecen en la zona denominada Cited Reference, ¿no? Donde podemos encontrar el doble, ¿vale?, de las citaciones, y que nunca había sido tenido en cuenta por los bibliómetros, fundamentalmente por un problema de control y de normalización, el mismo que puede tener Google Scholar. Bueno, ¿qué voy a decir a nivel internacional? ¿Es realmente Google Scholar internacional? Miren, simplemente tienen que ver las transparencias, vean lo que es Google Scholar y lo que son las otras bases de datos, con un sesgo anglosajón importante. En la parte inferior, en el caso de enfermería, en el caso de comunicación, las comparaciones todavía mejor porque podemos comparar cada una de las bases de datos con el mundo. Fíjense cómo Google Scholar se parece al mundo, bastante, mucho más variado. Esto en cuanto a países, pero también en cuanto a lenguas, ¿vale? Y si miran de nuevo la comparación respecto a lo que es el mundo, miren la primera columna de Google Scholar, la segunda, cómo se parece y cómo las bases de datos Web of Science y Scopus están sesgadas al mundo anglosajón, como es normal por el desarrollo de la ciencia. Pero es que lo interesante de Google Scholar es que es capaz de recoger todo tipo de documentos, En la parte superior vemos citas, en la parte inferior vemos documentos, en este caso de Anne Will Harthing. En la parte de citas ya ven que las citas procedentes de Web of Science y Scopus están exclusivamente limitadas a las revistas, mientras que en el otro caso hay documentos de todo tipo y condición. Y no los voy a leer todos porque son muchos. Claro, ¿esto qué hace? Que el retrato que nos ofrece Google Scholar sobre la comunicación científica sea distinto. Tienen ahí la lista de cuáles son los 10 trabajos más citados de 2016, esto lo actualizamos hace un mes, cuáles son los trabajos más citados en el mundo en Google Scholar, a nivel en inglés y en español. En el caso de inglés, solo 2 papers, y digo papers. En el caso de España, ninguno, todos son libros, e incluso vemos por ahí algún documento que nos puede resultar extraño, pero ahí está. ¿Por qué? Porque es citado por los investigadores. Por tanto, el retrato es diferente. El retrato es más omnicomprensivo, porque mi tesis, y la hipótesis que mantenemos en nuestro grupo, es que Google Scholar es capaz de captar otros impactos. Capta el impacto científico, al igual que lo hacen Web of Science y Scopus. No puedo hoy dar datos, pero tienen que saber que la correlación cuando medimos esto es altísima en todos los campos, por encima del 0,9, es decir, estamos midiendo lo mismo. ¿Y por qué estamos midiendo lo mismo? Porque Google Scholar ha engullido a la otra base de datos, las otras bases de datos viven en su interior, ¿vale? Pero además Google Scholar tiene documentos y es capaz de medir el impacto que yo llamo educativo, el impacto profesional, no incluyo ahí el impacto político, no creo que el impacto social, y demostraciones empíricas, siempre hay datos. Fíjense, este es uno de los productos que hemos hecho, haciendo un ranking a partir de Google Scholar de los investigadores españoles en biblioteconomía y documentación, y he sombreado en rojo personas que son compañeros académicos, pero que tienen un gran impacto profesional. Si utilizáramos Web of Science, que aparece, me parece, en la tercera columna, y ven su índice H o sus datos de citación, no les permitirían estar ahí. Si utilizáramos la Web of Science Scopus, estarían absolutamente desaparecidos. No están desaparecidos cuando utilizamos los datos y se puede calibrar su impacto en la comunidad, que yo creo que es bastante alto. Y bueno, el otro día hice una pequeña excursión con una revista que dirán, ¿qué demonios es esta revista? Pues sí, mi biblioteca, la conocerán los que estáis de aquí de biblioteca y poco más, muy digna, una revista casi divulgativa, pues miren, tiene 728 documentos, o 728, y me dediqué a analizar quién le cita, quién le cita, quién le cita desde el punto de vista de los documentos. Fíjense que las revistas están, pero ¿qué revistas? Si yo le dijera qué revistas, no son ni New England, no son el HACCP, no son el Journal of Documentation, son revistas de carácter nacional, de carácter en algunos casos local, de carácter divulgativo. Tenemos ahí, en segundo lugar, los seminarios, los congresos. En tercer lugar, las tesis, bien sean tesis de grado. Y bueno, y la panoplia es increíble. Hasta hay una memoria de oposiciones, citando. Impresionante. Y desde el punto de vista del impacto, fíjense la lengua. Spanish, el 94%. ¿Esto qué quiere decir? Que hay lugares, territorios, donde no se mide realmente el impacto. Solo se mide una parte del impacto. Bueno, justamente por todos estos datos es por lo que nosotros decidimos abrir la caja de Pandora. Y nos hemos dedicado durante 9 años de manera intensiva, extensiva y obsesiva. Reconozco que obsesiva. En ciencia no se hacen grandes cosas, sí, bueno, no estoy catalogando de que haga grandes cosas, de luego hago muchas cosas, como decía Rafa, con mi equipo. ¿Con quiénes? Con estos. Estos trabajan codo, trabajamos codo con codo, no a codazos. Enrique, Alberto, Juanma, son la clave de todos los productos que nosotros hemos hecho abriendo esa caja de Pandora, que son muchos, que se refieren a las revistas, especialmente el Journal Scholar Metrics, se refieren a los autores, el H-Index Scholar, que sacamos en 2012, una auténtica provocación para los investigadores de humanidades y de sociales. Yo pensaba que nos iban a tirar tomate. 50.000 investigadores de humanidades y ciencias sociales ordenados por números. La gente de letras ordenada por números, una auténtica provocación. Con el H y con el G, yo creo que, en fin, el G tiene su cosa, ¿no? Nadie protestó. Bueno, muy poco. Si yo le enseñara la lista de correos que hemos recibido, este es el indicador de la contaminación bibliométrica que vivimos en España. La ola bibliométrica llegó al Reino Unido en 2015. En España llegó en 1989. Por una vez España se adelantó y fue precursor. Me hubiera gustado que hubiéramos inventado una vacuna, pero no. Inventamos la aplicación a tutiplén, como decimos aquí, de la vara bibliométrica para medirlo todo, ¿vale? Bueno, pues hicimos ese producto, hemos hecho productos con ranking de editoriales y hemos entrado en el último, que es, creo que es la aportación. Para nosotros estos son experimentos. La gente piensa que hacemos productos finales. No, no, son experimentos para saber qué se puede hacer y cómo reacciona la gente. Y la gente en España reacciona de cualquier modo. Bueno, este es el Journal Scholar Metrics. No sé cómo voy de tiempo, supongo que mal. Ah, voy bien. Bueno, pues entonces ven que no voy a hacer propaganda de mi producto. Bueno, voy a hacer algo de propaganda. Aparte de incluir todas las revistas que hay en Google Scholar Metrics, hemos sido capaces de identificar 10.000, entre ellas 320 de comunicación, por tanto, interesante para este campo. Hemos creado nuevos indicadores y hemos, por primera vez en el mundo, me gusta decirlo, así, hemos averiguado la tasa de autocitación de algo en Google Scholar. La tasa de autocitación de algo. Lo hemos hecho. Estamos en disposición de hacerlo para otros campos. Lo que ocurre es que, bueno, hay que contar recursos. Hombre, me gustaría contar con el beneplácito de Anurag Acharya, el inventor de la cosa, pero esto es difícil, esto es difícil. Bueno, no puedo contar todos los productos que hacemos. de verdad y qué hemos hecho con Google Scholar, me remito a lo que hemos venido haciendo, pero les tengo que decir que nosotros siempre somos críticos. Alguien puede pensar que nos encanta, parece que Google Scholar nos paga. No, no nos paga, desgraciadamente. Ya me gustaría a mí que me pagaran. Seguramente no estaría aquí. Somos críticos. Bien, la principal crítica que se hace a Google Scholar, una de las principales son los errores. Bueno, nosotros indicamos hace 4 años, nos atrevimos a decir que la tasa de error en Google Scholar debe estar en torno al 10%. Y dirán, oh, Dios mío, el 10%, esto no lo toleramos en ningún área de investigación. ¿Qué tasa de error más elevada? Claro que cuando hablamos de Big Data, una tasa de error del 10% es pequeña. Bueno, ¿qué está ocurriendo con los últimos, con los pocos estudios que han surgido? Esperamos pronto tener el resultado de una tesis doctoral donde daremos ya resultados empíricos de manera global. Pues que el dato que damos, la hipótesis es cierta. No hay errores por encima del 10%. Por consiguiente, eso en una herramienta Big Data como es Google Scholar es irrisorio. Como yo digo ahí, incluso sucio mide más y mejor. Me estoy refiriendo que Web of Science y que Scopus, que ahora descubrimos que tiene errores. Pues claro que tiene errores. Es normal que tenga. Pero lo sorprendente es que cometa tan pocos errores un buscador que atraca en todos los puertos del mundo, en todas las lenguas, haciendo que los investigadores, recogiendo documentos que publican los investigadores como les da la gana, en cualquier formato. Me parece sorprendente una tasa de error tan baja. Yo creo que el gran peligro de Google Scholar y de todas las almetris que vienen y que vengan tiene que ver con la manipulación. Nosotros decidimos manipular el índice, los índices que se pueden generar de carácter bibliométrico con estos productos y quisimos demostrar que se podía hacer prácticamente por analfabetos digitales. Y se puede hacer. También digo una cosa, y esta fue la respuesta del ingeniero cuando se le inquirió diciendo que cómo su producto podía. Él dijo que era una cuestión de spam. Y dijo, todo se ve. Pues es cierto. Si uno hace cosas raras, se ve. Y se le ve. Hombre, nosotros quisiéramos que se le viera más fácil. Y es lo que le dijimos a Anurag. Hombre, ¿por qué no haces que aparezcan determinadas tasas de autocitación de las personas? Y así veríamos con más facilidad. Esto lo hicimos nosotros en INREX. Tengo que decir que INREX es un producto estupendo desde el punto de vista del diseño. Podíamos averiguar exactamente si una persona estaba manipulando el índice. Como decimos en Andalucía, llevaba la procesión. Ya saben que las procesiones andaluzas están soportadas por muchos horquilleros. Pues había uno que llevaba la procesión entera. Toda la revista se soportaba él. Bueno, él estaba abajo, pero también estaba arriba. Era un caso extraordinario. El barón de Munchausen, ¿vale? Realmente era así. Bueno, yo creo que este es un peligro importante, pero hasta cierto punto porque se ve. Creo que también este es otro, la dependencia de las tecnologías. De pronto, si un día Google desaparece, y Google Scholar, se nos cae el chiringuito. Claro, también pueden desaparecer otras bases de datos. Parece que otras lo que hacen es mutar. Easy, Thomson, Reuters, Clark, no sé qué, y no sé lo que vendrá en el futuro. Otro fondo de inversión, yo qué sé. Bueno, es peligroso tener dependencia de un solo producto. De luego, la falta de transparencia también hay que criticarla. Nosotros no sabemos. Sabemos que lo que hay dentro de Google Scholar es muy bueno. ¿Por qué? Porque están indizando toda la web académica, todas las bases editoriales, Elsevier, Springer, Wiley, todo. Y lo que está en los repositorios. Pero claro, no sabemos. Un bibliómetra no puede aceptar, como ahora supongo que nos dirá Ismael con el manifiesto de Leiden, oye, pues que tenemos que saber cuáles son las fuentes. Pues claro, que hay que saberlas. Y no las podemos averiguar. Perdón, sí las podemos averiguar. Yo creo, las podemos averiguar levemente. ¿Qué es lo que intentan todos estos productos que he mostrado? Pues básicamente esto. Especialmente en el área de ciencias sociales y humanas, que era una zona desconocida y, por tanto, la comunicación que habita en ese territorio académico, pues antes no sabíamos nada. Con Google Scholar vemos algo. ¿Vale? Bien. Y voy a terminar justamente hablando del... Yo creo que hay un cambio en el modelo de comunicación. Google Scholar forma parte de ese cambio. Y ese cambio tiene que ver con la aparición de una ruta verde. Hoy hablaba también con Joyce sobre esto y su creencia por el blog. Hoy cualquier científico puede seguir esta ruta verde, que consiste en que cualquier cosa que crea, que descubra, puede depositarla, la puede difundir a través de Google Scholar tres días, a partir de tres días cuando se deposita un documento en el repositorio está accesible, y después puede utilizar todas estas herramientas de difusión como son las redes sociales académicas, y a partir de ahí puede colaborar, compartir, hacer lecturas colectivas. Lecturas colectivas. Claro, Mendeley permite hacer lecturas colectivas. ¿Alguien las hace? No lo sé. La gente pregunta, responde. Sí, en ResearchGate la gente pregunta y responde. Por tanto, se fomenta la realización. Bien, la gran pregunta de la gente del Selecto Club, de la aristocracia científica, es ¿y cómo controlamos la calidad? Porque, claro, en el sistema tradicional se ha producido la evaluación ex ante, es decir, la evaluación donde los editores con sus revisores deciden qué se publica. Bueno, en el nuevo modelo posmoderno de comunicación es la gente. Habla, pueblo científico me refiero, pero también el no científico. Oiga, si yo publico un trabajo, mi trabajo está expuesto y puede ser comentado, criticado, revisado. Entren en ResearchGate. Yo pronto lo voy a practicar de manera sistemática, además como experimento. Voy a evaluar trabajos de compañeros que me interesen, analizarlo. Y pondré los comentarios para que la gente lo vea. Soy darwinista. Incluso dentro de esta masa, creo que lo bueno siempre sobrevive. Y he dicho, y con esto terminaré, voy rápido, creo que la evaluación es clave en la forma de comunicación. Lo advertimos en 2002, después en 2007, y a Gran Bretaña llegó la oleada o la contaminación bibliométrica en 2015, ¿vale? La evaluación condiciona. ¿Qué es lo que está pasando en la evaluación? Que estamos pasando de una bibliometría donde se evaluaba a unos pocos, por unos pocos y para unos pocos, a evaluarlo todo, por todos, para todos, en todos los lugares, a todas las horas, en todas las horas, cualquier cosa de la que hacemos se mide. La antigua bibliometría es una bibliometría cuyo epicentro eran las revistas, y todo se ha montado haciendo ranking de revistas y con un indicador que era el impact factor. Ahora hay un deporte olímpico que consiste en disparar contra el impact factor. No solo la declaración DOA, sino, DOA he dicho bien, sino el resto de manifiestos. Bueno, no toca ahora, pero yo cuando hay esta marea me gusta también defender el papel que ha podido tener el impact factor, pero no es el caso. Lo que quiero decir es que todo el sistema de evaluación pivotaba en las revistas. Hoy el sistema de evaluación se conduce a lo que yo llamo la all metrics. La all, no la alt. Todo se puede medir, porque todo lo que hacemos está en la red, porque dejamos nuestra huella. Y hoy tenemos muchos expositores. Hablo de expositores, de Mirror, de expositores. Y los expositores están en muchos lugares y hay nuevos metros para medir. Y nosotros justamente hemos generado ese producto experimental para mostrar todos esos espejos, y lo hemos hecho también con una provocación claramente, hemos entrado en la Counting House, en la casa de las cuentas o en la casa de las citas. A veces me gusta, dependiendo de dónde esté, juego con una cosa o con otra. Yo soy bibliómetra, pertenezco a esa casa, por tanto es una autocrítica, ¿vale? Estamos deconstruyendo. Los próximos análisis no pivotarán sobre las revistas. Hoy estamos haciendo aquí una jornada. Lo harán sobre los documentos y a partir de ellos de los autores. Formulo esta pregunta, que no voy a proclamar, porque a partir de ahora ya presento la transparencia y me callo. Un momento, no he terminado, todavía hay algo más inquietante. La gamificación, atentos al asunto, a la gamificación del trabajo científico y de la actividad. Estamos ante métricas que son narcisistas. Tendremos nuevas enfermedades, ya las tenemos. antes de que llegue la enfermedad, con su crudeza, la impactitis ya la hemos tenido, pero llegará la egotitis y no sé si otras cosas más. No sé si me gusta el mundo de ciencia que vendrá. No sé si las nuevas métricas pueden dañar a la ciencia. Y lo mismo tenemos que hacer un manifiesto 2. No sé si de Leiden o de otro sitio. Ahora sí que he terminado. Gracias.
Del café, y si no, lo haremos en la mesa redonda. Bueno, ahora pasamos a Ismael. Paso al inglés. Así que, well, now I would like to introduce the second speaker. He is Dr. Ismael Raffles. He received a PhD in biophysics from Tohoku, yes, in Japan. He was postdoctoral researcher in nanobiotechnology at Cornell University. Currently, Dr. Ismael Raffles is a science policy analyst at Ingenio, from CSIC, Universitat Politécnica de València. He is also associate faculty at SPRU, the Science Policy Research Unit, at the University of Sussex. Where he worked from 2005 until 2012. Well, Ismael investigates how to make more plural use of science and technology indicators for informing evaluation, funding, and research strategies. Currently, he's working on research portfolios, developing mapping methods to interrogate the research landscapes for grand challenges such as bird flu or obesity, so as to facilitate deliberation on research prioritization. He is also exploring inclusive metrics, trying to understand and correct for indicators biases and their effects on policies, for example, in issues such as local knowledge. Now he's going to present the Leiden Manifesto. So, Ismael, whenever you're ready.
Bon dia a tothom. Thank you. I don't belong to this field of communication, and I was wondering how I should present the Leiden Manifesto in this context. What I realized is that there was a lot of talk of evaluation in a conference that was about communication. And I wondered what that could be suggesting. My main area is research evaluation, and there I feel comfortable. But if you see here, these colleagues in Leiden, this is Sarah de Rijke, we're wondering whether journals now have become more a place to put things for so as to be evaluated, so a clearinghouse for career aspirations. Rather, she's asking whether journals have become more a place where we put things so that they are evaluated, so that people, organizations, universities become evaluated, rather than a place for communication. And the emphasis in this conference, which is about communication journals, on evaluation, suggests this potential tension between journals as a place to gain attention, to gain reputation, to gain excellence versus journals as a way of communicating either with the scientific community or with wider audiences. The classic view of academic publishing, as illustrated in the sociology of Robert Merton, is that journals were places where researchers would share their findings. They would share these findings for free with a community, a specific community, and the incentive to do so was that the community would award them reputation. But it was the community. It was not through bibliometrics. It was not people external to the community. Now, in the last 10, 25 years, in some countries earlier than others, I think Spain, as Emilio was mentioning, has been an early adopter. The reputation by peers has been supplanted by the quantified excellence. So that in sociology of science, it's talked about the change of reputation by quantified excellence. For example, Paradise talks about it. And some sociologists talk of the supplantation of the logics of the old science, which is by the community, the scientific community, versus what they call the neoliberal economy. And I'm not sure this is a term that I agree with, but let me just throw it that there are a number of people talking about the neoliberal economy, where publications, citations become the currency, and there is an economy around publication. Now, this has two types of effect. The effects are that there's a potential narrowing of the type of scientific activities, because people try to get the currency rather than producing or communicating. And there is the potential task reduction. So, and this relates to what Emilio was calling the gamification. I'm presenting this very much in a questioning mode. So I would like to hear what's the opinion, for example, of Professor Boyle, about, in the case of the UK, the use of four publications, which are then evaluated and have a huge impact on how many economic resources a department gets, and how whether this is happening and potential detrimental effects. Let me present this and say I feel a bit out of place, but. So let me present this a bit in a questioning mode. In front of these potential problems that bibliometrics was causing, we came up with the idea in the bibliometric community to have a manifesto. Now, the manifesto, though, acknowledges that, and we begin with the idea we are bibliometricians, that metrics, indicators, are important and useful. Why is that? Well, in the last 30 years, there's been this huge growth in the science system. 20 years ago, we had 500,000 papers per year in the Web of Science. Now we have 1.5 million. This is only in the Web of Science. In Google Scholar, the increase is possibly 2 or 3 times this one. There's globalization. Who knows, who understands which are the researchers and universities and departments in China, in Brazil? Only in Brazil, they have to evaluate 3,000 postgraduate programs. With this growth, it is helpful to have maps, to have numbers that help in order to navigate the complexity. There's also the issue of competition, both globally and locally, and the issue of the increasing societal demands. In a time in which there is demands for public money to show that it's producing something, universities are under pressure to show that they're doing something useful for society and do it in an efficient way. So, yes, they're very good reasons, and many reasons, why indicators, bibliometric indicators, other types of indicators, are important and are useful. They increase the transparency, they increase the sense of objectivity when making decisions, they reduce the complexity, they reduce the time and cost of making decisions. So indicators are useful. Now, the problem might be that we end up believing that these indicators represent the whole reality within science. And this is something that we can have a discussion with Emilio. I would disagree that everything that is in the web reflects what is happening in the world. There is limitation to how much you can capture and how much you can look at it. So there are many things happening which cannot be captured. Now, the dream of rationality, the science of science policy, might help us in taking decisions because we have numbers. Now, the question is whether we are making the right decisions. And there are a number of people like Daniel Saravitz, Andrea Saltelli, who are worried about the type of science that is being produced. Even magazines or newspapers such as The Economist in recent years have run articles asking about the problems in science, the potential increase in fraud, the potential increase in lack of reproducibility of the results. So there is a mismatch between the expectations of what science could deliver and the outcomes of research. This is happening in a variety of areas, in energy, in the environment, in health, the digital economies. And there's a perception that one of the problems is the discrepancy between the evaluation criteria in general, and in particular the evaluation criteria which are behind the indicators, and the social and economic functions of science. So something that could be very obvious sometimes is forgotten, which is that more publications, more citations do not necessarily mean better science or science that it's better for societal outcomes. And let me present a parable. That's a parable of the Prussian scientific forestry. In the Enlightenment, the Newtonian view of the world was dominant. So in the 18th century, the same way that Newton came up just 100 years before with these beautiful laws to describe the world, they also had a variety of approaches to better manage the world. One of these was scientific forestry. This was in Prussia, and in a moment in which wood was the main fuel, the enlightened policymakers tried to manage forest in a way that would be perfectly rational. In the end, the rationality was about a single number. They tried to increase the revenue yield of timber, the amount of wood that you would get from the forest. To do so, they started counting the trees in the forest, counting the different types of trees. But in a forest like the one on the right-hand side, in a wild forest, as they used to be, it was very difficult to have a good, reproducible yield. So in the end, they started to look by counting in terms of only the amount of timber, and they came up with a simple abstraction of simplification, which was understanding the forest only in terms of the trees, forgetting about the birds, forgetting about the bushes, forgetting about people hunting in the forest, people getting medicinal herbs for the forest. And the way they view the forest, the one on the right, which was, you know, complex, diverse, led us to transform it. And they started planting rational forest, which is the one on the left. The rational forest would have perfectly aligned trees. There would be no bushes. And it was extremely good in terms of increasing the yield of timber. The problem was that the soil was rich because of the diversity of trees and animals. because of a variety of insects doing a variety of environmental services. So they planted, when they planted the rational forest, they had a fantastic success in terms of increasing timber for one generation. The second generation was not so good. And at the third, but in the second generation, they started having plagues and lots of problems. So what they had to do afterwards, it was to introduce diversity, these insects, animals, artificially, so as to revert a little bit to the original wild forest. Now, this is a parable, I think, for what might be happening in science. Our focus in single measures might be reducing the diversity of activities, and we might end up with forests which are not sustainable, which might, we have with science systems that are focused only in things that we think important nowadays, but might not be important in 20 years' time. And things which might be important in 20 years' time, we believe now that they are the little, that they are unimportant, the bushes in the original forest. This is not something that happens only in science. When in the beginning of the financial crisis, there was a committee of experts, including Stiglitz, Amartya Sen, Fitoussi, actually presided by nobody else but Nicolas Sarkozy, which said that we had the same problem with GDP, that the focus on GDP was detrimental to generating a well-being in societies. Now, the question then is to ask ourselves, what is it that we value? Do we value more publications? Do we value more citations per se? Or are we genuinely interested in the intellectual exchange? An intellectual exchange in diverse areas. And Emilia was saying that, was asking whether indicators could do harm. I think that at this moment we have plenty of evidence, anecdotal evidence, we don't have quantitative evidence, that indicators can do harm. In front of this, in 2013, we started a series of deliberations in the bibliometric conferences, and we didn't really know how to go about fostering a better use of indicators. In a way, you know, we felt, bibliometricians, we felt like nuclear engineers working with radioactive material and knowing that some countries in the world are using nuclear materials for not very useful purposes, such as in places such as North Korea. And the question is, can we do, are we responsible at all to dealing with these nuclear materials? So the idea was to have a set of principles about good uses of bibliometrics in a way of fostering a responsible use. These 10 principles were published in 2015 in Nature, and they have had a wide reading. And what they try, what we realized in the debates we had in 2013, 14 in the community was that we could not come up with a tight standardization of how bibliometrics should be used. This is because bibliometrics is used in a variety of ways, in a variety of contexts. So we could only come up with general principles. And these are the principles, which are very related to the ideas which are behind the metric tight, which was a report published also in 2015 by Hefke, Hefke being the High Education Funding Council for England and Wales. It's a very interesting, thick document about good practices in the use of metrics. The 10 principles were meant, I have to confess, one of the goals was that individual researchers, when pressured by the head of the department or by evaluators, could go, hey, you know, that we've got this document which is in Nature, which tells us that we should not focus on this and this, or that we can also do this and that. The first one is that you cannot use indicators in a mechanistic way. And that in the end, Evaluation, assessment should depend on expert judgment. Indicators can help in informing the decisions, but they cannot supplant the decisions. This is a principle which is very simple, but in the Iberian Peninsula runs against the bureaucratic tradition of pretense of objectivity. Because of course, the choice is always made by somebody about which indicators you use, and depending on the indicators, there is value judgment. So this is a very important principle in countries with a strong bureaucratic tradition, such as those in most of Latin America and Southern Europe, and Eastern Europe, by the way. The second and third principle are about context. Indicators should reflect the goals and the missions of the research. So if we are doing research on health, and we have a number of university, hospital, consortia in Spain, which do fantastic research, these consortia should not be evaluated according to their impact factor, their number of citations. They should be evaluated about the outcomes that they produce in terms of the health. They should also protect excellence in locally relevant research. This is important given the biases that main databases have, as was clearly shown by Emilio, given the focus on Anglo-Saxon journals of the dominant databases, it is important to remember that a lot of research which is relevant might not be in the databases, and that a lot of relevant research and excellent research is published in journals that are not necessarily seen as important by the wider international community. The fourth and fifth principles are about transparency, so that the evaluation process is seen as fair and robust. And besides being seen, that it can be fair and robust, and that people can scrutinize it and propose alternatives. The 6, 7, and 8 are about variety, about diversity. Is the fact that science is not a single endeavor, but that science research thrives in diversity, means that very often you have communities that do not share the ideas of what is important. If you put sociologists and economists, they will clearly disagree on what is good research. If you put biologists and physicists, they will often disagree. In order to allow these disagreements in perspectives, which is one of the strengths of science, of diversity, you need to be able to acknowledge different types of value as given by each of the different communities, and these are not necessarily commensurable. And these differences in terms of variety of outputs are particularly important for when evaluating individual researchers, because some people focus on certain types of communities and certain types of activities, much more engaged with stakeholders. Some other researchers are more focused towards the international community. And you cannot compare these activities with the same indicators. And finally, the 9 and 10th principles are about the assessment being a social system in which the actors are capable of predicting what is happening in the system and reacting to it. This is what we call reflexivity. Given that we researchers are capable of changing our publications behavior, it is important that we think what are the effects in terms of the behavior of the researchers, and that we change the evaluation in a way that is sensitive to the potential effects. This type of principles were summarized in the metric tides in big principles such as humility, sensitivity to context, transparency, diversity, robustness, and reflexivity. How much time-wise, I should, 5 minutes? So in terms of, I just wanted to get to the manifesto, and then just to finish, let me finish with a reflection of what type of effects the current focus on narrow indicators might be having. So if you think of a space of problems in the world, and you think of a space of research that is addressing part of those problems, the current set of indicators is only focusing on a part of the research, which is covering only part of the problems. Now, the problem that we have when we are doing evaluation is that we mistake where there is the light with whatever, with all that exists in the world. Is the problem that of the drunkard looking for the keys of his car below the street light. So we mistake often the space of indicators by the space of problems and space of research. And this happens in a variety of areas. One of the areas which is very problematic is health. There's a lot of research on therapeutic measures versus research on preventative medicine, on understanding the environmental origins of lack of health. Poverty, for example, being one of the major reasons why people don't have good health. But most of the research in medicine goes to therapies. And we often don't, and so in terms of how we manage research, we are not addressing problems outside of the light. So the idea is that this focus in narrow indicators is contracting the space of research rather than expanding. And this is happening in a moment in which there is a lot of rhetoric about the importance of broadening the impact of science in the world, the issue about societal impact. So if we have to expand the space of research, the idea is that we'll have to expand the area of indicators. And in this sense, I think that the talk by Emilio showing that Google Scholar has this much coverage was a very clear illustration of how by looking at other sources of data, you might expand the area covered by indicators and potentially come up with more nuanced and more beneficial types of evaluation. So let me finish by the question I started with, and I'm sorry, being a Friday morning, that this is not a more cheerful question, but the question is whether we are so interested in gaining our credentials for excellence that we forget what research and what science is about. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Ismael. I think that your presentation was thought-provoking and quite interesting. Well, we have only 3 minutes before the coffee break, so I think that we are not on time to make now the question, to ask questions to the speakers. So please, if you agree, we are going to make now the coffee break. And at the end of the round table, you will have the opportunity to ask them your questions, okay? You will find some food for breakfast at the hallway of the auditorium. Please, I must ask you to come back at 11 o'clock to restart the session. Okay, thank you very much. Okay, we are going to restart the session with the keynote speakers. On my immediate left is Dr. Karen Boyle, and in my immediate right is Mr. Steve Smith. Steve is our next speaker. He is institutional sales manager in Qdos. Steve has over 15 years of experience working in academic publishing and with online platforms and tools to support workflows of the researchers. He has spent time at Emerald Group Publishing, ProQuest, OCLC, and Thomson Reuters before joining Qdos in 2016. Today, he's going to speak about Qdos, a platform for researchers, institutions, and publishers to increase the outreach and impact of their research publication, which provides unique mapping of specific promotional activities to increases in metrics. His keynote is entitled Maximizing Reach and Impact, Case Studies from Qdos. Yes, so Steve, whatever you want.
Okay, great. Can everybody hear me? Yeah. Okay. You know, the first thing I'm really interested to know, I mean, this is the first time I've come to Catalonia to talk about Qdos. How many people have heard of Qdos? Could you just show your hands if you've heard of Qdos at least? Okay, so it's not bad. It's about a third of the room. So it looks as though we've reached you already. So hopefully by the end of this session, at least 99% of you will have heard of Qdos. anyway, so yeah, as Raphael introduced, Qdos is all about boosting visibility and impact of your research publications. So quality research needs to stand out in the crowd and get read and reach the people who are going to benefit from it. So it's a little bit like this golden tulip in the field of lots of pink pale tulips. We want your research to stand out and get noticed. So hopefully it won't be too long before in the north of England where I'm from, these little things will start to come above the surface of the soil. Still not there yet. So what are we doing with Qdos? It's a free platform for researchers to come in and explain in plain language what their research is about and why it's important. And what we wanted to do with this platform, so Qdos is a young company. We've been going for about 4 years now. Our motivation was really to help universities, research institutions, and of course publishers to mobilize researchers, to motivate researchers to do more outreach and promotional work about their research to increase their visibility and impact. But what was our driver? Why did we think this was a good idea? And why did we think that it would be important for researchers to start to do this? Why? Really, it's all about pressure. Pressure in a number of different areas. So first of all, there's pressure over research funding, of course. There are more and more researchers applying for funding for the same pots of money. The money isn't particularly increasing. And so to be able to differentiate yourself and to demonstrate to funders and, well, potential funders that you've got good past performance of generating impact for your research, that you're reaching the people who will really benefit from the research, not just that you've got a lot of citations, but that your research is actually making a difference to the world. Demonstrating past performance, but also showing these potential funders on your application form that you've got sensible pathways to generating impact. Have you got a plan? Have you got a strategy, a clear strategy for after you've spent their research money and you've created your publication, will you be disseminating it to the right places? And will you be following it up and doing some outreach activity? So increasingly, actually, Qdos is being cited by researchers on funding applications as one of the pieces of evidence that's being used to say, yes, we do have a plan to disseminate this research. We have a growing impact agenda, of course, just across the board. So obviously, Karen is going to talk about the REF that we have in the UK, our research assessment exercise or research excellence framework, and no doubt you have similar things locally. But it's not going away. These bodies are going to require evidence of impact. So when it's coming to assessment time, being able to demonstrate this is going to be important. Just the huge growth in outputs, so simply demographics and the fact that more papers are being published now than ever before, that's not really surprising, but there's just simply a big, huge wealth of content out there. Actually, when you're publishing your latest piece of research, you're competing with many, many more people than you ever needed to before. So again, taking steps to making sure that your publication stands out is clearly going to be important. So we're helping with this fight for visibility and usage. And then we've got other issues which are perhaps more pertinent to publishers. So how many publishers or editors have we got in the room? Yeah, quite a fair few. So, I mean, you'll be able to tell me how important the issue of off-grid sharing is to you. I'm talking about platforms such as ResearchGate or academia.edu and your authors uploading and sharing their full text, which they may not have the copyright to do. And we want to help to avoid this situation as well. It puts people into a grey area, which we don't really want them to be in. So Kudos provides links to the full text to the publisher's website, so you get more traffic going to the right places, not just, you know, for potential revenue purposes for the publisher when people want to download your full text, but equally to make sure that usage is properly monitored and measured and collected. As well as providing a link to the publisher's website, how many librarians are there in the room? Okay, also good fair few librarians, some of whom I met last night, which was very pleasurable. Thank you very much for that. but librarians tend to be the custodians of the institutional repository. And this is, of course, a great resource which has the potential to be used much more in the context of generating impact and communicating research. It's not just a box where papers are kept and collected and you can access them there if you want. There's potential for the institutional repository to be part of the whole communications piece. And so Kudos also allows you to link to the full text, which might be available on green open access on the institutional repository. So what are we working to achieve? We want more impact for research, more recognition for researchers, but we also need to provide much better evidence to convince researchers, really, that, and how many researchers are in the room? Sorry, we haven't asked about researchers. How many researchers? Most of you are researchers. As researchers, you're probably thinking, well, Kudos, so it's a free platform, okay. ResearchGate, academia.edu, Mendeley, these were also free platforms. So you're giving me a fourth platform, are you, Steve, for me to put a profile on and start sharing my work? Thank you very much, Mr. Smith. No, it's not that. So what we want to do is really show you that if you've got 5 or 10 minutes available to promote your work, that it does actually make a difference and that your metrics are increasing. So if you explain your paper using Kudos on the Monday, and then you send that out by Twitter. It's now Friday lunchtime, nearly, and you're gonna be curious as to that 5 or 10 minutes that you spent on Monday morning, how many more readers have I got now? Have I got more readers? Are people tweeting about me now as a result of my promotional activity? I probably haven't got any more citations. Might have to wait a little bit longer for that. But you want to be convinced that it's really worth spending your time. So part of the Kudos platform is showing you a wide range of metrics and how those map up against the activities that you've done. Better collaboration as well. We also want to help to foster better collaboration within a university or at a publishing house. I would say that at a publishing house, it's easier because you've got your authors, you've got your editorial staff, and you have your marketing team. And so it's quite easy, isn't it, really, in the context of a journal or a group of journals, for the marketing team to be able to access the content which is being published by you as a publisher, and then share that out via social media to really disseminate it. It's quite a sort of, I would say, a flat structure within a publisher. What's much more difficult to navigate, however, is the structure that you've got at a typical university. So if you think about the different stakeholders who could have some influence and could lead to or contribute to the success of a combined communication and impact generation effort within a university, who have you got? You've got the researcher. So the researcher is great at being able to, you know, explain in plain language what their research is about and why it was important. They're the best person to do that. And indeed, in Kudos, that's what happens. You claim your paper, you explain it in plain language. However, what about social media networks and then sharing your explanation? Who's the best person to do that? It's not always the researcher, is it? Because you might be great at research, but you just don't have time, actually, to go into Twitter and Facebook and LinkedIn and Instagram and all these other places, constantly sharing things and making sure that you've got a growing network and that they're all engaged, all of your followers and so on. So you might not actually be the best person to share your own research. Departments of communication. So you've got departments of communication at pretty much every university, or marketing, PR, press, whatever they happen to be called. They could be useful, couldn't they? Because they do have these big communication networks. They do have these big social media networks with 20 or 30,000 people following the Twitter accounts. So they could be quite useful, at least controlling the top level of institution-wide social media accounts. But they also might not be the best people. Because if you look at who those 20 or 30,000 followers are, they might not really be that interested in your very niche area of research. So we need to find the social media channels where there is a receptive audience. The followers are interested in your research, in your discipline, and also that there's a lot of followers, maybe more followers actually than you have personally for your own personal Twitter account. So what we have in Kudos is this platform where universities can access the plain language explanations that you're writing, and then appoint administrators across the university. So they might be people, for example, who are running a departmental or subject-based or a research group Twitter account. They can see your explanation, and then they can tweet that out to their much bigger and ready-to-consume audience. Bringing this all together is not easy, but Kudos at least provides a platform to make that at least a possibility. And then the final part, the final stakeholders, are perhaps the research office or the people who are looking at the metrics. You know, how many more citations are we getting? Or are we starting to look at altmetrics? Are we starting to consider how much attention our work is getting aside from citations? Because this could be, for example, a pre-indicator as to, you know, where we're starting to have some, make some differences, where we're starting to, let's say, generate different types of impact before we have the evidence from things like Scopus or Web of Science or even Google Scholar and their citations. And who are those people? They might be in the library, they might be in the research office. It's handled by different people. But also bringing them into the picture so that they can see that the communication efforts that these teams are making between them are actually leading to material gains in measurable metrics. Measurable metrics. So how do we do it? So I'm going to, actually, rather than talking about this slide, I'm going to show you what this looks like a little bit later. Now, it's all very well me saying we have this new platform and you use it to explain your papers and share it and you're going to get more impact and you're going to find many more readers and so on. That's just my claim as a supplier, really, as Kudos. But we have had this independently tested by a group of people in the altmetrics team at Nanyang Technological University in Singapore. If you don't know that institution, the altmetrics team there is very well respected. It's quite a leader worldwide in the area of altmetrics. And what they did is they took a sample size of 4,000 academic papers which had been explained and shared using the Kudos tools, and then took a similar control group of 4,000 papers which hadn't. And what they found, well, there's no secret because it's there on the screen, what they found was that the papers that had been explained using the Kudos tools got 23% more full-text downloads than those that didn't. So that was the official study. We do hear from some of our publisher partners, for example, Emerald, who I used to work for, who tell us that for certain journals, they're seeing more like a five-fold increase in full-text downloads when Kudos is used to explain their publications. So the evidence seems to point to the fact that Kudos does work, and that was very good validation, really, for the around about 3 years of work that we did building the platform to that point, because until that point, we couldn't be completely sure how effective Kudos was, so we're starting to see some evidence now. So what's the workflow then? So I'm going to show you what the workflow is for the researcher starting up with a new Kudos account. So I don't know if you want to take any photos here or if you want to scribble this website down, because I'm going to give you something for free right now, your own Kudos account. So you can do this. You don't need a publisher or a university to back you. You can just do this yourself. You go to growkudos.com. Can you see that down there? Bottom left, growkudos.com. And then you register yourself an account there. It takes about 30 seconds to complete the registration form. And then when you click on the confirmation link in your email, then you're ready to start promoting your papers. So number two is find a work. So you then want to find the piece of research, find the paper that you really want to promote right now. And that's how it's different from things like ResearchGate or academia.edu. This is not an online profile site at all. This is a toolkit to promote a specific piece of research. So what you don't do with Kudos is register and then claim every paper that you ever written or co-authored. You don't do that. Please don't do that. When you think about it, I mean, if you started explaining a publication which you had published 6 or 7 years ago, and it doesn't have any particular relevance in today's world, actually your Twitter followers might be confused as to why you're suddenly starting to promote this old paper. So start with the most obvious paper that you want to promote, probably your most recent publication for most people. So most people will start off just using Kudos once for one paper to promote that. It may be the case that you had a paper published a couple of years ago and it just didn't have the kind of reaction from the community that you expected, and you were disappointed. And certainly your funder was disappointed, right? So you might want to go back, find that paper, and then give it the Kudos treatment as well. But this is absolutely not an online profile site, just to make that clear. Having said that, we do have a partnership with ORCID. That's that green symbol up there. How many people have got an ORCID? Okay, a very well-trained audience. So if you've got an ORCID and you've already claimed all of your papers or some of your papers in your ORCID account, then when you register with Kudos, you simply add in your ORCID ID. And then any papers that you've claimed, as long as they have a Crossref DOI, will be there available in your Kudos account, ready for you to promote. So when you've done that, the next thing, number three, this is the hard work. This is the hard graft, number three. Explain your research. Now, most of the people in this room, they'll be working in the area of communications and media studies, right? Is that right? Okay, is there anyone working in any other disciplines here? Actually, yeah, okay. It's kind of cheating, but yeah, I know what you mean, Ismail. But communications and media studies. So for the most part, if you think about the title and abstract that you're submitting for your paper, it doesn't generally contain language so technical that a non-expert could completely fail to understand the purpose of your research. Is that fair for me to say? Yeah? I mean, there might be one or two occasions where you are, you know, using some technical terms which people from outside communication studies would fail to comprehend. But anyway, this is your chance, regardless of which discipline you're in, to put your research into plain language so that, indeed, a non-expert could understand. So this would perhaps admittedly be more pertinent to, let's say, a life science or natural sciences audience or medical sciences audience, putting it into plain language so that everybody can understand. Because the purpose here is not just to reach people in communication sciences, but to a much wider audience, to the public, anyone who could benefit from your research. Once you've done that, you might also want to add some other resources. So if you've got video links, or if you've got data sets that are relevant to your research, or if you've got an infographic or other links, then you can also link at the explanation page and sort of create a hub, if you like, an online hub of all the resources that exist about that research. Right, then the next bit is the exciting bit, really, because this is when you get to share. So number four is sharing. So this is where you link up your Twitter, Facebook, and LinkedIn accounts, if you've got them, and then you share that explanation page. So that's what people are going to read when they click through on the link. So you want to make sure that you do a really good job of number three. If you want to share on ResearchGate or academia.edu or Mendeley, then that's absolutely possible through Kudos. You simply generate a link and then copy the link and paste it to those places. So if you've already got a good network in these other sites, you should also use it. There's no reason why not to. The interesting thing is that wherever you decide to share, so Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, or these other places, ResearchGate and so on, wherever you decide to share, you're going to get feedback in the form of metrics as to which channel, so which social media channel, or which blog, or even if you emailed a contact group, which of these activities led to the biggest increase in new readers or new people interacting with your research. So that mapping, that correlation between activities, promotional activities, and increasing metrics, that's what really makes Kudos unique. Okay, let's move on. So here's an example. This is what a Kudos page looks like. You've got the original title and a link to the article at the top. You can see this is from a Royal Society journal. And underneath, you've got the what it's about and why it's important text. So this is what the researcher is writing. Sometimes people ask me about Kudos. So have you invented some kind of special linguistic algorithm to create by machine a plain language explanation from my abstract? And the answer is no, we haven't. And we're not going to try to do that either. So the researcher is always going to have to do this bit. I actually think it's quite good that robots can't completely replace humans in every function of our life. Don't you? I certainly do. You can also see that this person has, on the right-hand side, added some resources. So one of the resources you could add, and I'm just going to embarrass somebody in the room at the moment, Mireia. Where's Mireia? Hi, Mireia. So Mireia has used Kudos. This is her real life example, so hopefully you can see that. So this is one of her first efforts at using Kudos. So a nice plain language explanation and also a personal perspective. But look what she's also done. She's added on the right-hand side here, knowing that the people who click on this link from her Twitter feed might not have subscription access to the journal in question. But it's held on the UPF institutional repository here. So if I don't want to spend 30 or 40 euros reading the full text, I can perhaps access it here from the UPF repository. So that's quite a nice thing to be able to do. There's the original article. So she would then share it. That's what the share screen looks like. Then she's got her metrics. So she can keep an eye on these to see how these are progressing. So what have you got there? You've got the number of times that it's been shared, the number of clicks on the shares, the views on Kudos. So this number is sometimes bigger than this number because the search engines are also crawling Kudos pages. And when you think about it, when you're writing your plain language explanation, you're going to usually generate more language, more let's say, lay terms about your research than you did in your original abstract. So it's possible that a user of Google could discover your work without using the kind of technical search terms in their Google search. So it potentially makes it a bit more discoverable as well. You've got the clicks through to the read the publication. You've got the altmetric score. How many people are familiar with altmetric, this multicolored donut? Not that many. Okay, the thing is, I don't have much time really to talk about another company's product, and it is another company's product, but we have a partnership with altmetric. What altmetric does is, very briefly, it aggregates a number of different indicators, not only from social media, but also, you know, have you been cited on a Wikipedia page, or has your work been cited in a government document policy? Are you mentioned in any newspaper websites or blogs on the web in all different languages? So this altmetric company tracks all of these mentions about your publication across this really wide range of different media. So it's really interesting, actually, to be able to see that in the context of, your sharing, how this number is increasing, and then also to be able to see exactly who is tweeting about you. So look at this. Already, Mireia has had all of these different people tweeting about her work, not just herself, but, you know, all of these different people. And actually, if you're on this screen, if you're on the share screen here, and you've just done your plain language explanation, and you don't really know where I should be sharing it, then actually the altmetric screen could give you some inspiration about where you could share it, or, you know, which hashtags that you could use. If another Twitter user is using particular hashtags to talk about your work, maybe you could experiment and use those hashtags also. So, yeah, actually, I'll just show you a little bit more. How am I doing for time, Raphael? 2 minutes. Okay. So back to the metrics screen. I've also got this detailed metrics, which I just wanted to show you. So this is where you've got that mapping, that correlation between the activity that she's done to promote her work and the increasing metrics. So what you can see along the bottom is the date, and along the y-axis you've got the metrics. If we've got it available, we add the full text downloads from the publisher. So the publisher sends us this information, and we can add the full text downloads as well. In this case, what we've got is information about what Mireia has done. So she's claimed the paper there. And at this point here, this is when she shared it via social media, as well as adding this explanation text. So you can see that at this point, the metrics increase. The views on Kudos increase. The click-throughs to the Kudos page increase. And then we add the full text downloads on top of that. So when I'm talking about motivating the researchers to do something to increase their outreach, this is what I'm talking about, being able to show them that by putting a few minutes effort in, it really does start to pay off. Okay, I did have some more material. I'm running out of time though. Maybe I can give that to you over lunch or later this afternoon. But in the meantime, thank you very much.
Okay, so thank you, Steve. Thank you very much for your presentation. It was quite interesting invite to try Kudos. It was very, very, very nice. Okay, so now, now, last but not least, we have Dr. Karen Boyle. She's professor of feminist media studies and research director in communications, media, and culture at the University of Stirling in UK. In the 2014 Research Excellence Framework, Karen was a joint output assessor for panel 55 that includes the areas of music, drama, dance and performing arts, and in panel 36 including communications, cultural and media studies, and library and information management. She sits on the executive of MEXA, the UK Subject Association for Media, Communication and Cultural Studies, and she is on the editorial board of Feminist Media Studies and Sexualization Media and Society. She regularly undertakes peer review for a wide range of journals and publishers, as well as for other academic institutions. In relation to her research interest, she has largely focused on gender, violence, and representation. Also, she is author of Media and Violence, Gender in the Debates, editor of Everyday Pornography, and she has published widely on all these things in academic journals and edited collections. Dr. Karen Boyle will present now the second keynote entitled Publishing Info Ref in the Communication Field in the UK.
Thank you. Thanks for inviting me to be here today. A few caveats before I start. What I'm going to try and do today is talk through a little bit what REF was, what it's likely to be, as far as we know, at this point, which is somewhat up in the air. But I'm going to try and focus on what it means for communications journals and those of us who publish in them. But my big health warning on this is that I'm not here to cheerlead for the REF process and say that this is the way that everyone else should do it. Very far from it. We were discussing over coffee that many of us who are involved in these processes find that we're in the position of trying to advocate the least worst solution. And certainly that's a discussion we're going through in the UK very much at the moment, largely hinging on how evaluation will take place in the next exercise, the role of peer review, and to an extent, the role of metrics. So I will talk about that, but only very briefly. What I want to try and get to at the end of this talk is to gesture towards what we're trying to do at Stirling and in other organisations where I've been undertaking peer review as part of a REF preparation process, which is to try to think about how we might use some of the quality judgments that drive REF in a way that's hopefully much more individually and personally constructive than the process often feels. So just very broadly to start with then, REF, which other speakers have gestured towards already, is a means of assessing the quality of research in UK universities. It's been going for a long time, or at least it feels like it's been going for a long time, formerly as the research assessment exercise. And it takes place every 6 to 8 years. The last exercise was in 2014. REF assesses quality, but it does so for the purposes of determining the distribution of government funding. So it's by no means a neutral process, and it's one that universities invest a huge amount of money and anxiety in, shall we say. As you can see from the panel titles that are on my slide and in the introduction, the REF assessment process is organised around very broad subject groupings. And for fields like ours that are very multidisciplinary, this can present a number of challenges, which I'm happy to talk about in questions if that's helpful. Universities choose which panels they submit to, at least they do currently, and which individuals to include within the submission. So it's a selective submission process, or at least it was in 2014. My own role in the last exercise was primarily as an output assessor, which meant that I was reading the work that my peers produce, monographs, journal articles, book chapters, but also, and although I won't talk about this much, I'm happy to answer questions about it, in the two fields, music, drama, dance and performing arts, and communications, media, cultural studies, library and information management, there were a number of practice-based submissions, so people submitting practice as research, films, databases, photography, other forms of production. So that's maybe something we can think about in relation to the challenges that poses for things like some of the metrics models we've heard about today. I assessed around 450 outputs in the last exercise, and that was in a period of about 8 months. So you can imagine that was quite time consuming. And that's what I'm going to try and draw on today. So I want to, first of all, just give you a very little bit of background on the last exercise, if I can work out how to actually advance this. Is it just on the... There we go. Okay, so the last exercise then, the definition of research that's used by the REF is up there on the screen. And there's three elements that were evaluated in our process of evaluating the quality of research in UK institutions. And they were outputs, which I'm going to focus on today, which made up 65% of the score for a unit of assessment submission. Impact, which was new in 2014, and environment. And the words in italics are the key words that were used to make quality judgments in each of these areas. I would just like to pick up on something about impact, because I think impact, we use that term in a number of different ways in academia. And impact in the way that Steve was talking about it, in terms of dissemination, how many people read your work, is not what was measured in the REF exercise. To demonstrate impact in the REF exercise, you had to be able to demonstrate almost like a change in behavior or a change in the way something was thought about. So impact as a quality measure is not about the quantity of your dissemination. And I think that's quite an important caveat here. The other really important thing to stress about the REF process is that it was, and the proposal for next time is, still will be, largely based on peer review. So for outputs, everything was read by two reviewers, and we could bring in a third if there was disagreement. And two really important points to note here for all of the panels that fell within humanities is that the type of output was not taken into account in any formal way. So we weren't asked to look at which journal something appeared in, at the impact rating of that journal, or the number of citations a piece had. We were looking literally at the piece of work itself. So metrics was not a formal part of the process. We had access to metrics data if we wanted it, but our panels, the panels I was involved in, did not use metrics data. Okay, so just very briefly, what did we find? Well, I mean, I suppose the good news, the headline good news story, is that we found that our field is a field in rude health, and I'll talk through what these categories of 4, 3, 2, 1 star and unclassified mean in a moment. But 4 star is the highest quality rating, and we found that 29% of all submissions, or 23.4% of outputs, were at that top level. And when I show you the descriptors, you'll see that that is really quite a high judgment to make. There were 67 submissions to panel 36, which is the one that I imagine most people here would be interested in. And you can see there the number of outputs we assessed. I've put a quote there from the report that went back to the sector from panel 36, because I wanted to pull out 2 points about that, 2 points from that quotation. The first thing to say is that all kinds of output were found to exist in all of the quality levels. So we assessed 4-star films, unclassified books, 4-star journals, unclassified journal articles. So everything fell at every quality level. That said, one thing that panel 36 in particular found, and this is interesting in terms of thinking about where we might place our work, the shorter pieces of research, is that book chapters came off the worst by quite some way. Now, of course, there were book chapters that were 4-star, but on the whole, why I'd say book chapters came off the worst, and I'd reflect on my own work in a very similar way, is that often there's a less rigorous peer review process, not always, but often. I think one of the key reasons that book chapters can fall foul of REF is that the book chapters are read on their own, and sometimes they're left, they're less self-explanatory about their significance in the context of an edited collection than they might be within a standalone journal article, because the introduction written by somebody else makes that case for the significance and originality of the work. And so that's something that I'm kind of increasingly discussing with colleagues as they choose where to place their work. The other challenge I think we found with book chapters is that people were often kind of trying to shoehorn their own research into somebody else's big idea, and so that could be a less comfortable fit sometimes. But also book chapters on the whole were shorter than journal articles, and although length is not a prerequisite of rigour, and there are certain sort of more scientific areas within communications where very short pieces could score very highly indeed, as a general rule, it's much more difficult to attain the levels of quality in short pieces. And so I'll just take you through now what those quality levels are. So these are the overarching descriptors that were published for what 4-star, 3-star, 2-star, 1-star, and unclassified work, what that work was. Two things I want to say about this. Firstly, that they are exacting criteria. You know, if we judge something as 4-star, we are saying it is world-leading in terms of originality, significance, and rigour. The other point I want to make about this is that the funding really shapes the way these judgments are made, because last time the cutoff for funding was at 3-star, so only work deemed 3-star and above was deemed fundable. And so although we're making quality judgments, we're also making quality judgments in cognizance of this broader funding context. I want to take you through now the slightly more detailed quality descriptors, because I think these are useful in trying to just give a sense of how we define quality, and perhaps sometimes why that kind of quality can't be easily metricized. This is the detailed descriptor of 4-star. And I think you'll see kind of immediately from reading this that not all research can or should be 4-star. And indeed, we all publish research for a variety of different audiences, purposes, and so on. And we should still be able to do that. There were certainly journal articles that were graded at 4-star. But if you think about the description of research offering a major expansion of the range and depth of research and its application, you can see that that kind of judgment can be quite difficult to achieve in shorter pieces of 7 to 10,000 words. But I also think it's really important to state, because certainly in some areas in the UK, you get this kind of, oh, you've got to publish a monograph, it's got to be a monograph, you need a monograph, that's going to be 4-star. I read monographs that were judged at 1 and 2 stars. There's absolutely no guarantee that writing a monograph is going to, in itself, ensure that you reach these quality descriptors. Because 2 and 3 were really where the key decisions happened, because they were the places, you know, where the decision was about funding, I thought it would be useful to just briefly run through what we thought made a journal article, for instance, 3-star and not 2-star. Because this is what I think institutions are most exercised about now. How do we ensure that we concentrate our work in 3 and 4-star? And probably the first key thing to say there is to remember that in this process, those of us who were reviewing work were assessing the output and nothing else. So when it comes to criteria like determining if it's a recognised or important point of reference, if it's had influence, what we're looking at here is whether it deserves to be those things, not whether there are metrics that prove it has been these things. And that's a really, really important distinction, and it's necessary because of the census period that the REF covers. So in the last exercise, we looked at work that was published between 2008 and the end of 2013. So material that I was reading may have literally only been published a month ago. So the idea that we could use metrics as a way of kind of tracking the quality of that is obviously deeply troubling. For me, another key distinguisher around the 2-3 borderline was whether work was thought to be a catalyst to new thinking or new approaches, or seen to be an incremental and cumulative advance, with the incremental and cumulative advance being, for me, really the very definition of 2-star work. So 2-star work is still quality that's recognised internationally. It's high-quality work, but it tends to perhaps be a bit more focused, a bit more modest in its claims. I just want to say something about recognised internationally and recognised nationally, because I think it picks up on the point that Ismail made earlier about locally relevant research. It's absolutely not the case that to achieve the highest quality level, something had to be international in scope and comparative in scope. So, for instance, you could have a piece of work on Welsh language television that's very locally specific, that still achieved those highest standards because it was absolutely achieving all these criteria in the context of its own field, and that might be quite a small field. Work in that small field that achieved the highest standards of 4-star would be more likely to gesture to broader debates. So in the example of Welsh language television, it might gesture to broader debates about media and minority languages, or it might engage with broader debates about public service broadcasting, for instance. So it could still be making a contribution to debates internationally about public service broadcasting, although its focus was really quite specific. Okay, so that's where we were. Where we are is a matter of some speculation at the moment. We're undergoing a review, and there's a consultation published by Lord Stern, which is out at the moment, closes next month, and the link's there if anyone wants to look at it. So there's a number of proposals about the next exercise, but for our discussion today, I think the most important of these are that outputs are still going to be the single most significant factor. So the research quality of institutions is still going to largely be determined by outputs. There are other aspects there I can talk through if people are interested. But two other things here is that the process is still going to be based on peer review, largely based on the metric TIDE, which was mentioned earlier. Stern is proposing only to use metrics in an advisory capacity if panels wish to do so. So the likelihood is that for our subject areas, metrics will not be used in a heavy-handed way at all. The other thing which has already come in is an open access requirement, however, and that relates partly to some of what Steve was talking about, and I'll pick up on that. So the idea of sharing and disseminating research being really key moving forward. Okay, so just to wrap up, I want to sort of run through what I learned from reading 450 outputs or watching some of them or interacting with some of them. And what I'm trying to kind of use this to think about my own writing, but also the work of my colleagues. One thing it's just worth saying at the beginning is that editorial work in and of itself is very difficult to claim as research. When I moved institutions, when I went to Stirling, one of my last publications was an edited volume, and I had fully intended to submit the entire edited volume to REF and was strongly advised by one of my colleagues not to do so and to submit a journal article instead. And considering the amount of time my edited book had taken versus the journal article, I felt a bit sick. But actually, he was completely right, because, of course, I was making a judgment about the value of the editorial collection that wasn't necessarily based on my work. It was based on the quality of other people's research contributing to that. So had it been judged for me, the person wouldn't have read the whole book. They'd have read my chapter in it, and I did have journal articles that were stronger than that. So editorial work is important. That kind of work's important for our research environment, but it doesn't count very well in REF. I'd say that at the moment where we're heading is that open access is more important than journal rankings. So not all journals in our field do have impact factors. And Alistair's going to talk about Screen later. Screen's one of those that doesn't, a very, very prestigious journal in film studies. So I would say that open access and ease of access to material is going to be more important than journal rankings. But within that, although where something matters, where something's published doesn't officially matter, the reviewers are your peers. The reviewers are people in this room. And so I suppose we do unconsciously or consciously bring to the table understandings of the reputation of particular journals, of whether something does or doesn't fit within them, and that might impact on the way we think about significance. I'd also say that journals, and this is one of the reasons, again, why book chapters didn't always do so well, is that journals have been through a rigorous process of peer review. And as you can imagine, if I read 450 outputs, I wasn't reading outputs that were all things in which I would classify myself as expert. So knowing that something has already been peer reviewed by people who are expert in that field is some guarantor of quality. Even things like the quality of copy editing started to sneak in. Really badly edited books really got on my nerves. But I think the other thing that I've learned about journals is that doing peer review really helps you understand peer review. And so when and where you've got the opportunities to engage in peer review, I know it's one of those academic citizenship jobs that we don't really get credit for and we do for free to keep journals going. Having said that, I think it's a really good way to learn about how you write and how you present your own research. But also to be aware of the different criteria and of value. So the criteria a journal are using won't be the same as REF, and just to have those different criteria in mind. And then just two kind of final points. Sorry, I don't quite know how I did that. Don't know how that came up, but there we go. What I've been discussing with colleagues recently is, what's the magic formula? How do we write with REF in mind? And I think the thing is that there is no magic formula. Variability is very key. Some journal articles won't ever be refable, and I would be really, really sad if universities moved to a context where they simply weren't encouraged and weren't supported. Sometimes we need to be able to write commentary and criticism pieces in a really quick way to respond to really important current issues. The fact that they're not based on 10 years of research, evidently that all that isn't visible in the 2,000-3,000 words, shouldn't stop us engaging in that process. I think one of the things I've found, we've just gone through a mock ref process at Stirling, and when I've been giving colleagues feedback that they've had from external readers, one of the things that they'd often say, I'd say, oh, well, they said this is a really good case study, but it doesn't really gesture towards a broader debate, and so we're seeing it as 2-star, not 3. And the colleague would say to me, yes, but what it does is it advances the debate in this and this and this. And I'd say, okay, does the article say that? And they'd go, oh, well, no. Okay, so that's what the article needs to say. So we actually need to think about the way we write our abstracts, our introductions, our conclusions, so that they're actually clear, not just to, you know, the 6 other people in the world who really know your area very, very well, but to the 6,000 other people in the world who are interested in the broad parameters of what you're saying. And that also, I think, means that you've got to think about quality rather than quantity of outputs from a specific research project. One of the deputy principals in our university talks about salami slicing of outputs and being really against the salami slicing of a research project into lots of slices. And I think, I mean, as a reader, not as a reviewer, but as a reader, I find it massively frustrating when I read, oh yes, but if you want to know about this bit of the research, read the other article. And often that can really undermine the score of an individual piece for originality or significance, because, you know, a third of the article is saying exactly the same as the other article over there. And so really thinking about making that one really valuable contribution rather than maybe 3 more middling ones. Although I do understand that that's often at tension with priorities around recruitment and promotion, so it's not an easy fit. And the other thing that I learned from talking to colleagues about the peer review that they received was the importance of benefiting from peer review, but not allowing it to distort fundamentally what you want to say. And I think that's really important, because we've got to have integrity as scholars, but also if peer review is coming back saying, well, this, and you know, often anyone who's submitted to a journal will know this, you can get 2 reviews, one of which says, this is absolutely perfect, please don't change a thing apart from the comma on page 3, and another review that comes back 2 or 3 pages saying, well, really, I wanted you to write this article, and you haven't written this article. And it's just about making sure you find your own voice, I think. In terms of how I now advise colleagues to think about where they publish, fit is key. Timeliness, and I think this is where in certain subjects within our field, we really need to think about balancing the rigor of a long peer review process with the timeliness of publication. And I think that can be really key in areas like journalism studies. I was having this conversation with a colleague recently who'd written a really important piece to do with journalism, but had actually published it as pieces of journalism sort of for a couple of years before he then consolidated it into the academic article, which meant that the academic article was no longer original and didn't have the same kind of reach as it could have had otherwise. So timeliness, I think, is really important. Open access requirements, I've mentioned those, they're not going away, ensuring that we meet them. I think that also means that the attitude towards online-only journals is changing. I think maybe in the not last but process before, there was a kind of snootiness towards online journals that I think is going. And I think it's going largely because much more established scholars are now publishing in those journals as well. So if you're trying to decide about an online journal, looking at who's published there already is no bad idea. Space, how many words does this publication need? If it really is a 10,000 word article, don't write a monograph. I think that's the thing I'd most like to transform in academic cultures, is that we all write less, more succinctly and more powerfully, but that's based on the experience of reading 450 outputs, of which about 80 were monographs. And then also finally, just in that, special issues I think are incredibly valuable. Often we want to be in special issues because we want to be visible in our field, we want to be shaping a specific debate, but sometimes they can also mean, a bit like the book chapter, that we end up having to shape our research to someone else's agenda, and so that's just something I think to be cautious of. So that's what we've learned from the process. I'm absolutely not cheerleading for it or saying this is the model that we should have, but trying to find a way of working within the model that we do have. So I'll be happy to take any questions.